Hello friends, how are you? How is everyone? So friends, today's class is basically focusing upon the development of the answer writing skills that is there. How you have to write a good answer so that you can be in a position to score very good marks. The discussion will be concentrated and focused around this topic only. Not only this, but I would also be taking up various important questions which can be asked in the upcoming mains also. And I would be discussing how to write a model answer on that. Kis tarike se aap unke model answer likh sakte ho. The questions would be covering different paper 1, 2 and etc. 3, the kuch papers questions honge. And with the passage of time, it will be useful for you to, in the context, to know that how you can be in a position to write a good answer in a time-bound manner so that you can be in a position to score good marks. And we would be starting with a question. Very, very recent question, definitely you must have read in the newspaper. The question is, friends, before we start off the question, we have to make the certain things very clear. Certain things has to be clear basically in the context. For example, there can be different questions which are being asked. The different questions which are being asked, for example, it can be in the context of discuss. It can be in the context of comment. It can be in the context of analyze. This is basically a wide domain jiske daire mein question puche jate hain. Discuss can be there, elaborate can be there, comment can be there, critically comment can be there, analyze word can be used, critically analyze word can be used, etc. This is wide domain. And therefore, whenever you are preparing a question or whenever you are preparing a topic, prepare in such a way that chahe wo question discuss ka hai, comment, critically comment ka hai, analyze, critically analyze hai, you should be in a position to cover that very comprehensively. Discuss question which is there, that can be started from two points. Do tarike se aap isko start kar sakte hain. Firstly is from a historical background. Second thing you can basically start is from a report. Then you would be writing various things which have been asked. And the crux of that will become the conclusion. It's a conclusion over there. Jo iska conclusion hai, in simple words, will become the introduction of this part. Or we can also start this question from a report also. Second thing. And then you will be writing comment, positive, negative, jaise bhi pucha ja chuka. There is no hard and fast rule ki 50-50% positive, negative, agar comment, critically comment, 60-40. To be very clear on this issue, that will depend upon the and that will vary from a question to question. That will depend upon question can be said in the context that there may be certain questions in which the ratio would be 30% positive, 70% negative. There may be question iske ulta bhi ho sakta, 70% positive, 30% negative. Therefore, there is no hard and fast rule, but aapko dono paksh likhne padenge. Third thing is in the context of analyze. The word analyze means compare. And to write an introduction, jab aap iski introduction mein, jab aap example jod dete hain, that will become analyze. Kisi bhi question hai, uske agar analyze hai, to aapko introduction mein hi example likhne padenge. The word analyze will mean means compare. And comparison can be done only when you know a positive of a certain thing और अ नेगेटिव ऑफ अ सर्टेन थिंग। कंपैरिजन आप तभी करते कर सकते हो जब आपको किसी चीज का पॉजिटिव और किसी चीज का नेगेटिव पता है। एनी स्कीम देयर वेदर इट इज अ सक्सेस और फेलियर एनालाइज द स्कीम एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा। सो दिस इज अ वाइडर फ्रेमवर्क इन विच यू हैव टू राइट अ गुड इंट्रोडक्शन एंड देन फॉलो अ बॉडी पार्ट एंड अ कंक्लूजन। Do try to definitely write example if the question is analyzed, critically analyzed, examine, वहाँ पे आप example लिखने की कोशिश करिए। And this example, friends, it is very much important that they have to be covered from newspapers and not from any magazine. Because for example, there are various topics which are coming, अलग-अलग topics आ रहे हैं। Recently, for example, there was topics, for example, in the context of blockchain. Blockchain technology is there. The question can be regarding that also. The question can be regarding cyber security also. Question can be there. The question can be basically regarding it can be regarding the problem of Naxalism. The question can be basically regarding privacy. The question can be basically regarding Article 370, Section 370. And 35A. The question can be regarding anything in this regard. For example, cyber security. For example, Naxalism. If these things are coming up, cyber security, for example, ek Ashok Kumar ki book hai, wahan se kar sakte hain. Naxalism, aap wahan se kar sakte hain. But if you have to deal the topic of cyber security and you have to deal with n number of examples, I would suggest you to follow, for example, Indian Express for this topic. Beautifully it has been explained. Naxalism, problem, solution, latest, what the government is doing to deal with the problem of Naxalism, it is very beautifully explained in, for example, Indian Express only. Privacy issue, bahut behtareen tarike se the Hindu ne deal kiya hai. The blockchain technology, blockchain and land records, bahut hi behtareen tarike se live mint ne usko cover kiya. Blockchain technology, how this technology can be used in, for example, in the land records, etc., etc. So there has to be a wider framework how the questions has to be written in this regard. It becomes important that apne padhna kahan se hai. Paper 1, social issues, that is contemporary. Paper 1, geography, that is current geography. Paper 2, almost all. Paper 3, almost all. You have to do these things basically from the current affairs, and that is from the newspapers. Friends, there is no better source than covering the newspapers comprehensively, reading those articles. Initially, it can be somewhat difficult, but with the passage of time, this is one thing that will reap the best benefit for your preparation. Read the newspaper very religiously, basically in the context that you basically have to solve a particular number of questions from that particular thing only. The maximum number of questions can be solved from the newspaper itself. काफी हद तक आपके क्वेश्चन वहां पे सॉल्व हो जाएंगे. So do not think कि अगर मेरा आज का newspaper रह गया तो then what will happen? Hardly make any difference. Because newspaper is one of the most important arena when it comes to current affairs. Basically in the form from the mains also. Try to read Hindu comprehensively. Hindu ke saath saath the next thing is the ayah are various things that are coming in Indian Express. There are various articles that are coming. Explained aata hai isme, aapko pata hi hoga. Explained aata hai isme. Third thing is there is a separate page that comes basically on governance. Recently it has started, it's very very important page. There is a page that is coming up on agriculture that also comes once a week. when you deal or reading for explain to kafi behtareen kafi time se aa raha hai aapko pata hai governance is something very new. This governance topic will be helpful for your preparation basically in paper 2 and also it will also help in paper 4, for example in the context of the case studies when you have to do various examples. Agriculture is also very very important. So when you are reading the newspapers, make proper notes out of it. Not only this, but along with this, certain other things becomes equally essential. For example, Hindu, Indian Express or kuch articles aapko live mint se bahut behtareen mil jayenge. Plus, I would suggest you to read, for example, the recommendations of Niti Aayog. आप नीति आयोग के रिकमेंडेशंस को पढ़िए, बिकॉज व्हेन यू आर रीडिंग द रिकमेंडेशंस ऑफ नीति आयोग इट इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट ऑथेंटिक सोर्स दैट कैन बी मेड अवेलेबल. मेनी टॉपिक्स आर कवर्ड एंड दे कवर्ड फ्रॉम करंट पर्सपेक्टिव, फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट, एंड दैट विल डेफिनेटली गिव यू एन एक्स्ट्रा एज, एक्स्ट्रा मार्क्स व्हेन यू आर रीडिंग द रिकमेंडेशंस ऑफ नीति आयोग एंड राइटिंग देम इनटू द पेपर. व्हेन यू आर रीडिंग नीति आयोग देयर आर सर्टेन रिपोर्ट्स व्हिच आर इंपॉर्टेंट, फॉर एग्जांपल इंडिया एट द रेट 75. First thing. Second thing, the important report in this regard is artificial intelligence. Niti Aayog draft. That becomes important. Third thing, for example, doubling farmer income. And very selective reading has to be done from 3-year action agenda. So these are the fundamentals in which you have to cover it very comprehensively. Plus, jo bhi standard books you are reading, I would suggest you for paper 2, paper 3, this Niti Aayog ho gaya, or so various issues from, for example, from सेकेंड ए आर सी से कुछ इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यूज हो सकते हैं, फ्रॉम द न्यूज़पेपर्स देयर कैन बी वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यूज, योजना कुरुक्षेत्र हो गया, मेनी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक्स कैन यू कवर डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम देयर. दैट इज द बेस्ट एंड ऑथेंटिक सोर्स दैट यू कैन नो फॉर दिस पेपर 2 एंड पेपर 3. वर्किंग अपॉन डेवलपिंग अपॉन दीज आई वुड बी डिस्कसिंग वेरियस क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम विच दैट आर इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम एग्जामिनेशन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. And to discuss those questions, I'll keep the basics and subject, for example, basics plus the current affair. Both would be there. And basics plus current affair ke saath milte hi aapko aage wala discussion hoga. For example, the question that can be there in the exam is, in politics, hero worship is a path to degradation and eventual dictatorship. In this context, discuss Baba Sahib's view. The hero worship is a path that will path to degradation and eventual dictatorship le aayega. Is context mein ki hero worship hona chahiye, nahi hona chahiye, ya kaise bhi kisi context mein, we have to discuss the views of Baba Sahib Ambedkar. When you talk about hero worship in our country, it is very much important in the context that it is endemic to our country. It is very, very essential and endemic to our country, hero worship. Just go through the question once again. In politics, hero worship is a path to degradation and eventual dictatorship. कि राजनीति में अगर आप हीरो वर्शिप को देखोगे, दैट विल बी लीडिंग टू डिग्रेडेशन, बिकॉज यू आर मूविंग टुवर्ड्स अ पाथ ऑफ डिक्टेटरशिप. In this context, view Baba Sahib ke views discuss karna hai. Hero worship in our context, in the context of India, is something that is very endemic to our country. Especially at a time when the personality cult in our country is flourishing to a great extent. There is nothing wrong in admiring our great leaders who have made great contributions and to recognize that they are our leaders, they are our heroes. But along with this, there is a risk that is involved in this process. The tendency of this point of time would be basically is to entrust such persons with a vast power and uncritically accept the exercise of these powers without insisting upon ki aapki accountability honi chahiye or aapki accountability nahi honi chahiye, which is a sine qua non of any genuine democracy, which is a very much essential aspect of a democracy. When Ambedkar, he was delivering a speech in the Constituent Assembly, he uttered three warnings that can be there in a democratic country. One pertained basically to the danger of eschewing the constitutional methods for unregulated street protest, which he criticized that there would be a grammar of anarchy that would be prevailing. The second drew a distinction between political democracy on the one hand and social democracy on the other hand. He says that उन्होंने जो किया पॉलिटिकल डेमोक्रेसी सोशल एंड इकोनॉमिक तीनों के तीनों को लेने की कोशिश करी थी. ही ड्रू क्लियर डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन पॉलिटिकल डेमोक्रेसी ऑन द वन हैंड एंड सोशल डेमोक्रेसी ऑन द अदर हैंड. ही सेड विद कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन एवरी एडल्ट सिटीजन हैव द राइट टू वोट. दस वी टू विन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन इटसेल्फ वी हैव बीन सक्सेसफुल इन एंश्योरिंग द पॉलिटिकल इक्वलिटी इन द कंट्री. And yet, on the other hand, he said that on the social plane, when it comes to societal area, societal arena, there is a graded inequality that is prevailing, which means that there is an elevation of the some people and the degradation of the other people. कुछ society को अपने आप में ऊपर मानती हैं, others are considered as degraded. सो पॉलिटिकल में चाहे पॉलिटिकल इक्वलिटी हमें इंट्रोड्यूस कर दी गई है, बट देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द सोशल इक्वलिटी व्हिच इज नॉट प्रिवेलिंग. द सेम इज अ प्रॉब्लम व्हेन इट कम्स टू द इकोनॉमिक एस्पेक्ट आल्सो. ऑन द इकोनॉमिक प्लेन वी हैव अ सोसाइटी इन विच इज अ ह्यूज अमाउंट ऑफ द वेल्थ दैट इज इन द हैंड्स ऑफ सर्टेन कैटेगरी ऑफ द पीपल. On the other hand, there is other category of the people which are compared to this abject poverty that is prevailing. Yahan pe puri poverty prevail karti hai. We have a society in which on the one hand poverty hai, on the other hand there is a huge amount of the wealth. If this disjunction that is prevailing between the political rights and the social disprivileges that continue to persist, it warned Ambedkar that those who are suffering from inequality, जो इनइक्वलिटी सफर कर रहे हैं, दे ब्लो अप द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ पॉलिटिकल डेमोक्रेसी. पॉलिटिकल डेमोक्रेसी के स्ट्रक्चर को भी ब्लो अप कर देंगे विच दिस असेंबली हैज बीन सो लेबरसली बिल्ड. दीज टू वार्निंग्स दैट आर देयर दे रिमेन परसिस्टेंट. हाउएवर देयर इज एज पर द इलेक्शंस प्रेजेंट इलेक्शन पर से there is a third warning that was given by Ambedkar that need to be recalled very urgently. This he asked the Indians in the context that they should not blindly or uncritically follow any political particular leader. Blindly or uncritically किसी भी leader को follow करने की जरूरत नहीं है. Ambedkar, he said that the liberal thinkers, for example, he quoted John Stuart Mill and said that the citizens of democracy must never lay their liberties at the feet of the great men. If there is a country that is democratic country, that the citizens of democratic country should not lay their liberty, apni liberties kisi aur ke pairon mein nahi rakhni chahiye. And thereby should not trust him with so much of power that he may be in a position to subvert that particular institution itself. On the one hand, Ambedkar remarked that there is nothing wrong in being grateful to the great persons who have throughout their life rendered very long services to the country. But he says, he makes it clear that there are various limitations which are there to gratefulness. No man can be grateful at the cost of his honor. Cornell ko quote karte hue bole कि नो मैन कैन बी ग्रेटफुल एट द कॉस्ट ऑफ वुमेन कैन बी ग्रेटफुल एट द कॉस्ट ऑफ हर चेस्टिटी. नो मैन कैन बी ग्रेटफुल एट द कॉस्ट ऑफ हिज ऑनर. नो नेशन कैन बी ग्रेटफुल एट द कॉस्ट ऑफ इट्स लिबर्टी. अपनी लिबर्टी के कॉस्ट पे कोई भी नेशन ग्रेट नहीं हो सकता. The same thing he cautioned that far more necessity is the case of India than in the case of any other country. For in India, he said that there's two things. When you're following a path of devotion in the context of religion, that is something separate. Path of bhakti in the context of religion, that is something separate. But when you're following path of bhakti, basically in the context of politics, that may be leading to giving high amount of power, concentrating high amount of power into the hands of one person without any accountability of that person. Bhakti or path of devotion plays a part in the politics that is unequaled in magnitude any other part of the world. Bhakti, when you talk about religion, is basically the road to the salvation of the soul, mukti prapt karna hai. But when it comes to politics, bhakti or hero worship is a sure road to degradation. Wahan pe kya hai? Aap salvation ki baat kar rahe ho. Yahan pe kya hai? Aap degradation ki baat kar rahe ho. To the eventual dictatorship that it can be there. Ambedkar, when he was there, he was very much critical of the excessive adulation that was being done of Mahatma Gandhi by the countrymen. The blind following that was there of Mahatma Gandhi, of Jawaharlal Nehru, of Vallabhbhai Patel. Because of this enormous amount of the respect, that the prestige that these people they commanded. No doubt that he made it clear that no doubt that Congress Party had participated in the in a struggle for the country of the freedom. These people, they went to jail. And therefore, they should be respected. But that does not mean that it is now that the people should be giving them exact amount of, for example, control without any questioning even to these leaders. No doubt that you are our heroes and we have made great contribution, but that does not mean that even when we have become independent, we should not be held accountable in this regard. And Ambedkar was very much aware of the upcoming dangers that can be seen. Therefore, he underlined the importance of, basically in the context that of observing caution. Which, for example, in the case of John Stuart Mill, had uttered that to all who are interested basically in maintaining democracy. He said that not to lay their liberties at the freedom of the great man, or to trust him with power which enable him to subvert their institutions also. Or jahan usko itni power de dena, un institutions ko hi khatam karne ke bare mein soche. There's nothing wrong that we can be grateful. It's not wrong at all for those persons who have rendered the lifelong services for the country. But that does not mean that there is no limit to their gratefulness. Aisa matlab ye nahi ki unki gratefulness ko koi limit hi nahi honi chahiye. He emphasized that the caution is far more necessary in the case of India. Why? Because in the context of our country, in the context of politics, the devotion that can be then seen is unequaled in magnitude by any other parts in any other country. The devotion, for example, as we have discussed earlier, when it comes to devotion, is there in the context of religion, you are basically following the path of devotion or salvation of the soul. But in the context of politics, Ambedkar said that bhakti or hero worship is basically a short road. You are moving towards degradation, and that will lead to eventual dictatorship. As he commented in the context of Mahatma Gandhi, in the context of Jawaharlal Nehru, in the context of Patel also, or any other leader. On the last day of the assembly, Ambedkar pointed out the perils of life of contradictions. He said that we are going to enter into the life of contradiction. In politics, on the one hand, we are having equality. For example, everyone can be there to contest the elections. But on the other hand, in the context of society, in the context of economy, there is a good amount of inequality that is prevailing. No doubt that politics, one man, one vote, one value has been there. There is a good amount of social or economic structure inequality that is there, that is denying the principle of one man, one value. तो इस कंटेक्स्ट में आप पूरे का पूरा क्वेश्चन लिख सकते हो. वेरी प्रोबेबल क्वेश्चन दैट कैन बी देयर इन द अपकमिंग मेंस एग्जाम्स 2020 और इवन इफ यू आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर इंटरव्यू दैट इज अपकमिंग जो लोग सिलेक्शन सेलेक्ट हो जाएंगे इंटरव्यू के लिए. इट बिकम्स वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन दिस कंटेक्स्ट की ऐसे क्वेश्चन आपको मेंस में तो पूछ ही सकते हैं बट इवन इट द सच क्वेश्चन कैन बी देयर इन द कंटेक्स्ट ऑफ इंटरव्यू ऑल्सो कि अम्बेडकर साहब के हीरो वर्शिप के लिए क्या व्यूज थे. I'll repeat the question, then we'll move to second question. In politics, the hero worship is a path to degradation and eventual dictatorship. In this context, discuss the views of Baba Sahib. A very, very important question. Friends, while I'm taking up the discussion of all these things, if there is any student who want to inquire anything about the preparation of UPSC, UPSC ki tayari ke baare mein aap kuch puchna cha rahe hain, just let me know and we'll work on accordingly. Next question also very very important. Good conduct automatically result in good governance and bad conduct is a prescription for corporates to go downhill over a period of time. Signify the statement that agar good conduct hai, that will be leading to good governance and bad conduct is definitely a prescription for the corporates. If corporates agar bad governance karenge to wo niche chala jayega over a period of time. इस स्टेटमेंट को हमने सिग्निफाई करना है. देखो व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट गवर्नेंस इट इज बेसिकली अ प्रोसेस वेयर बाई द एलिमेंट्स इन सोसाइटी यू विल बी वील्डिंग द पावर एंड अथॉरिटी एंड देयरफॉर एनेक्ट पॉलिसी एंड डिसीजंस कंसर्निंग द लाइफ public life that is there, concerning the economics, concerning the social development that is taking place. Whenever same principle is being extended to the corporate governance, it would mean basically the manner in which the management is prescribing the code of the prescribing the conduct of an organization. जब आप कॉरपोरेट गवर्नेंस की बात करते हो वहां पे होगा इट वुड बेसिकली मीन जब आप सेम गवर्नेंस के कंसेप्ट की मैनेजमेंट किस कंटेक्स्ट को क्या क्या प्रिस्क्राइब करती है कंडक्ट ऑफ की ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हमारी कैसे कंडक्ट करेगी. दिस आल्सो मीन्स दैट द गवर्नेंस इज ओवरआर्चिंग एंड द कंडक्ट इन दिस इज द वे बेसिकली फॉर एग्जीक्यूटिंग द गवर्नेंस दैट हाउ द गवर्नेंस एंड अदर स्टेप्स वुड बी टेकिंग. By design, when you talk about the corporate governance means abiding by law and regulation, basically in the letter and spirit that has been given. The same way, ensure that all the statutory obligations are being discharged on time. Of late, it also encompasses the manner in which the board or the committee meetings are conducted. And how the decisions are manipulated with the passage of time. When you talk about good corporates, they believe in the full and fair disclosure of the approaches to all the stakeholders. What is the approach that would be followed by them? It would be made clear. The chairman's speech, the meetings of the board that would be reported. The management discussion analysis that is taking place that would be reported, notes on accounts to financial statements that are there, and there would be easy disclosure of all those informations in the context of good corporate governance. But the problem is that at times there are various corporates that become victim of selective transparency. सेलेक्टिव ट्रांसपेरेंसी का मतलब अगर आपको लगता है कि ये चीज़ आपकी इन्फॉर्मेशन आपके गुड कंडक्ट को या गुड वैल्यूज को प्रमोट करेगी आप उसको शेयर कर देते हो कुछ ऐसी इन्फॉर्मेशन होती है जो आपको लगता है कि दिस मे बी अफेक्टिंग दिस मे बी हार्मफुल फॉर द डिसीजन आप उसको रोक लेते हो. देयरफॉर देयर मे बी सर्टन कॉर्पोरेट्स दैट मे बी फॉलोइंग विक्टिम्स टू द डेंजर्स ऑफ द सेलेक्टिव ट्रांसपेरेंसी एंड दिस इज Always, there is always this danger of selective transparency versus the full transparency that is there. It is again a function of the personality of the CEO or MD that is there. If CEO is there, he is going for selective transparency or CEO aisa hai jo full transparency ko promote kar raha hai. If he is speaking directly from the heart, all the board agenda papers would be also reflecting the same. And if it's not that type, the paper will also show cause the other thing. The evolved organizations, they ensure that full and fair disclosure is being done, basically in the respect of almost all the items which are there in the agenda papers. What information has been discussed? And if all those things are being made clear, it becomes very much important that a particular corporate is following the practice of good governance. And that is leading to enhancing the quality of decisions that has been taking place. Kaise hoga, for example, the minutes of the committee or board meeting should ensure that there is a full transparency of all the relevant decisions. Jitne bhi relevant decisions hai that is affecting the interest of the corporate, of the stakeholders and any other people who is involved, those decisions has to be taken, and the how and why the decision was taken, that should be conveyed with full transparency. While there are no standard formats for minutes of the minutes of the meeting, ki aapne kis tarike se meeting ke minutes ko maintain karna hai, kis tarike se maintain nahi karna hai. The corporates, they should evolve their own format. Corporates ko apna format hi evolve kar dena chahiye. While taking into consideration the complexity of the agenda items that are there and the nature of the decision that has been taken, ki usko mande nazar rakhte hue, we have to formulate a particular standard that how the decisions are being taken, how the minutes of the meeting has to be recorded and how other relevant decisions are there. The value system is there, or for example, every company that will be basically imbibed in the day-to-day conduct your top management ka ho raha hai. The corporate, when you talk come about corporate governance, it is basically consisting of two parts. The first is with the internal management, how the corporates are conducting with the internal management, basically in the context of workforce ke saath, kaisa wo conduct kar rahe hai. Second, how they are conducting with the external stakeholders. For example, other shareholders can be there. For example, vendors can be there. For example, regulators can be there. For example, customers can be there, etc., etc. Many things are there. Therefore, in this context, it becomes important that how you are behaving with others also. The corporates, they spend enough time and energy in adhering to good conduct that are emerging as basically as a clear winners. Agar aap good conduct follow kar rahe ho, there would be certain corporates, they would be emerging as a clear winner. Jisko log bhi bolenge, theek hai, you are fulfilling the objectives, you are fulfilling various ideas, you are fulfilling various agendas and maintaining transparency into the system. Therefore, the conduct of the corporate would be basically flowing from the personal attributes of the leader. What are the attributes of leader? Kis tarike se leader ke attributes hai? For example, if he is swiping his access card first coming into the office, then others will also follow him. Others will also be coming on time. Although we live at a particular age when there is a flexible timings, morning, evening, nights, for etc., the good corporate conduct will always be setting an example at the top level of early entry and late exit from the office. There are also corporates that are focusing on ensuring that every small creditor is being paid immediately as per the time. Ki jitne bhi small creditors hai, they are being paid immediately. This is an example of exemplary corporate conduct. Bahut hi badhiya conduct. जिससे भी जो आपकी क्रेडिटर्स है उसको पे करो, टाइमली पे करो. डू नॉट वेट कि चाहे आपसे आपने जितना भी किसी से पैसा लिया है, यू शुड बी पेइंग इट. कर्टसी एंड वार्मथ डिस्प्ले टू ऑल द पार्टीज दैट आर वेस्टिंग द ऑफिस. फॉर एग्जांपल, द वेंडर्स दैट आर देयर, द कस्टमर्स दैट आर कमिंग, द सर्विस प्रोवाइडर्स दैट आर कमिंग, द प्रोस्पेक्टिव एम्प्लॉयज दैट आर कमिंग. द कर्टसी एंड अ वार्मथ मस्ट बी इंश्योर्ड टू एवरीवन. And therefore, if this is there, you will be leaving a very lasting impression in the minds of the people. People would be thinking, yeah, theek hai, chahe apne usne aapko job pe rakha, chahe usne aapko job pe nahi rakha, but that person was good to talk to. एंड दैट इम्प्रेशन विल ऑलवेज बी दैट. जब भी वो कहीं पे जाएगा व्हेन पीपल वुड बी टॉकिंग, आपकी बात उसको याद आ जाएगी कि उस इंसान ने ऐसा बोला था एंड इस इंसान ने ऐसा. देयर विल बी अ कंपैरिजन, अ पॉजिटिव इम्पैक्ट, अ पॉजिटिव इमेज ऑफ योर्स विल बी क्रिएटेड ऑन द माइंड्स ऑफ अदर पीपल. अनदर एग्जाम्पल ऑफ गुड कॉर्पोरेट कंडक्ट is where the companies ensure that no element of the personal expense is being charged on the company's account. कि आपका जो personal expense है वो नहीं चार्ज होना चाहिए companies के account के ऊपर. There are enough checks and balances which are there in the areas of propriety in the Companies Act, for example, in the Income Tax Act. Basically, that to ensure that the personal expenses are not being charged to the revenues. But despite all these prevalent that are there, there are certain shades of grey are also visible, where some of the expenses have both element of personal and element of official also. There is a model code of a conduct which has been formulated by various other corporates, which can be an agenda for others also. Basically, in the context that, for example, Tata Motors. The Tata Code of Conduct will be embracing the spirit of IPO, very, very important. IPO, meaning integrity, pioneering, unity, responsibility and excellence. A very, very important term in the context of code of conduct when it comes to corporate governance, model code of conduct. Namely, integrity, pioneering, unity, responsibility, and excellence. These can be there for the box that is relating to integrity, epitomizes the ideal corporate conduct that can be there. It says that we will be comparatively honest, fair, transparent and ethical in our conduct. Everything we must be doing will be standing the test of public scrutiny, that is IPO. Integrity, pioneering, unity, responsibility and excellence it stands for. Google has also a code of conduct, has two distinct compartments. And that compartments can be, for example, the first would be relating to the external world, which can be in the context of praise you. That is privacy, responsiveness, take action, integrity, security, freedom of expression, and usefulness. It is in the context of praise you as well. The privacy hai, responsiveness hai, take action hai. Integrity, security, freedom of expression, e-expression, and usefulness. The integrity when it comes to Google is basically on the trust. That is a trust that has been imposed, which states that our reputation as a company that our users can trust is our most valuable assets. That it is the integrity of reputation kis pe depend karta hai, the users they trust us. And it is up to all of us to make sure that we continually earn the trust more and more day by day. All of our communications and other interactions that are taking place with other users should increase their trust in us. Jitna bhi humara communication hai, jitna bhi humara interaction hai users ke saath, that should continually develop their interest, their trust in us. The other department basically deals with internal management, which will be including, among other things, the harassment and the safe workplace. That there is no harassment that is taking place, the workplace is comparatively safe. The common link in both the code of conduct is a customer. Every organization has now moved towards a customer-centric approach that is being followed. In the end, you can write your answer, conclude the answer. He's saying that with so many first generations and first startup companies that are coming up, it is very vital, it is very essential to instill in them the importance of the good governance and the good conduct. किस तरीके से गुड गवर्नेंस है, किस तरीके से गुड कंडक्ट है, वहाँ से बहुत ही ज़्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट हो जाता है. द फर्स्ट जनरेशन दैट कंपनीज दैट आर कमिंग अप, द स्टार्टअप कंपनीज दैट आर कमिंग अप, इट इज़ वेरी मच इंपॉर्टेंट दैट दीज कंपनीज विच आर कमिंग अप दैर लिविंग अप टू द एक्सपेक्टेशन द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ गुड गवर्नेंस एंड ऑल्सो फॉलोइंग गुड कंडक्ट. For this to be successful, the training sessions on corporate governance, they should also have modules of good conduct. So training sessions hoti hain corporate governance se, wahan se bhi bahut zyada essential ho jata hai ki aap good conduct ke modules ho. It is this thing alone that will ensure a sustained and a profitable growth that is taking place for the corporates. In the end, you can write these words. The crux is, for example, in the context that the best corporate social responsibility that corporates can undertake is first ensuring that they can conduct themselves with decency and courtesy while dealing with the stakeholders and the community at large. We have to conduct themselves with decency and courtesy also. After all, when you have to say the charity begins at home. If there is any documented code of conduct that is there, is good on paper, the true test is lying in its application in the correct way. We do not require a very heavy brains to understand that a spate of a corporate frauds and corporate scandals that are taking place in the country or that have already taken place is basically a result of the bad corporate conduct, resulting into bad corporate governance that has taken place. The Swachh corporates that are there, they should be an integral part of the Swachh Bharat mission that is there. Agar Swachh corporate hai, toh usi hisab se corporate level pe hum Swachh Bharat mission ko success bana sakte. It is in this way that you have to write a very good answer. The discussions of these basically being coming in various newspapers, the examples, for example, Praise You ho gaya, for example, iPure ho gaya, kuch bhi other hai. Hello. All these examples have been coming from different newspapers. It is very much essential that you have to cover the examples in a very comprehensive way. Then only you will be in a position to. Agar same thing, aise examples aap, you will not be able to find in the books or other things. Because these are the latest developments that are taking place. As it is in the context of, for example, Tata ka aapko bataya hai. Therefore, kahan pe aapko milenge, it is the examples that are basically coming in the newspapers. वहां से आप अपने क्वेश्चंस को सॉल्व करने की कोशिश करोगे, डेफिनेटली यू विल बी इन अ पोजीशन टू राइट अ वेरी गुड आंसर. द क्वेश्चन वाज गुड कंडक्ट ऑटोमेटिकली रिजल्ट इन गुड गवर्नेंस एंड बैड कंडक्ट इज बेसिकली अ प्रिस्क्रिप्शन फॉर कॉर्पोरेट्स दैट दे आर गोइंग डाउनहिल ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम. सिग्निफाई द स्टेटमेंट. वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन. आपको पेपर फोर में डेफिनेटली इसी तरीके से क्वेश्चन पूछा जा सकता है. वो मुझे थर्ड क्वेश्चन दैट इज देयर. This question will take up. United Nations Security Council is an institution which was set up after the World War II and therefore seems unsuited in the 21st century. ये कैसी organisation है? Institution है जो World War II के बाद set up हुआ था, लेकिन 21st century में comparatively ऐसा लग रहा है कि unsuited है. What are the reasons for the need of reforms in United Nations Security Council? Also highlight that what are the reason for opposition to the reforms also. What can be the possible points that can be covered in this? Kya topic, kya points ban sakte hain iske liye? We'll talk about this in the present context. It is very much essential that there is no equal distribution of the power that is there. With no equal distribution of power and the veto power being concentrated only in few hands. Not only this, but even at a time when EU is being aptly represented and reflect Western values and interests also. In the case of US, the geographical location and being the largest financial contributor to the United Nations, it can stop any move that it finds that it is hampering its interest. Wo rok sakta hai. Not only this, but when you talk about the population, the 4/5 of the mankind is living in the developing countries, and 4/5 of the mankind has only one representative in the permanent member, 5, that is China. Along with this, the growing imbalance between the developing countries and the developed countries' representation in the council, it is being reflected clearly. Not only this, but no permanent member from South Africa and Africa and Asia, only China, yet the biggest continent, Asia, ki wahan pe sirf ek hi representative hai. Along with this, it also does not reflect the economic realities of the present world. When the organization was formed at that point of a time, the economic scenario was comparatively different. Now the economic scenario is comparatively different. For example, France and Britain, they were the greatest economies at that point of time. Their rule has long away been taken up by Germany and Japan on the other hand. That are basically now became the second and the third largest contributors to UN budget. And therefore, they also deserve that a permanent seat should be given to the council. In 1945, there were only 51 United Nations members. In that case, 51 members, so 11 council members were there, adequately representing almost all the voices that are there. When you talk about today in the present context, the membership has risen by almost 4 times. The number of original numbers. And yet they are being represented by only 15 voices in the council. In that case, it becomes a problem. The Security Council expansion would make it even more democratic, as there would be good amount of participation that would be coming, and the transparency would also be there in the decision making, transparency in the councils. But despite the fact that there is a genuine demand for the expansion of the council that should be taking place, there are various oppositions to the reforms also in the council. The oppositions can be coming from a variety of reasons. For example, UK and France. Two countries, UK and France, they are holding the veto power over any amendments. For the reason that they are completely unwilling to give up their seats. Or in this context, mein two countries that are there, they are unwilling to give up their seat. Or if Germany ko add karte ho, that would mean there are 3 permanent seats from the council. That would be over-representation. And therefore, that will not be a fair geographical distribution of the things. Not only this, but despite the fact that at Germany and Japan, these two members are being suggested. Although both are rich, but they are not that much deserving. Although both are rich, they are presently struggling with their economic power over a decade. Other countries, they have continued to grow. Compared to other nations, Germany and Japan are also comparatively militarily insignificant. Germany ki bhi army koi jyada nahi hai, aur Japan ki ab sabko pata hai bahut hi limited amount of military significance is there. Not only this, but there are also various hostilities within. In the context that there is a lack of consensus among the developing countries themselves on who should get a permanent seat. Ki kisko permanent seat milni chahiye. Egypt is there, Nigeria is there, South America, Africa is there. I'll claim their right to an African one, that it is their right that should be there. Most deserving candidate India is also being opposed by various Muslim countries who do not want that a permanent seat should be given for them. In the context of India, there is opposition. also opposite Spanish speaking neighbors, they oppose Brazil because it speaks Portuguese. जो भी साउथ अमेरिका के हैं दे आर बेसिकली ब्राज़ील जो पोर्चुगीज स्पीक करता है स्पेनिश लैंग्वेज बोलने वाले जो उसके नेबरहुड है दे आर ऑल्सो बेसिक अपोजिंग द कैंडिडेचर ऑफ अ परमानेंट सीट बेसिकली टू ब्राज़ील इफ यू एक्सपेंड द काउंसिल बाई गिविंग फाइव मोर कंट्रीज अ वीटो पावर दैट वुड मेक इट इवन मोर डिफिकल्ट to negotiate on various issues. Ab jab five countries hain, it is becoming comparatively difficult to come to a final conclusion. Kabhi ye veto power exercise kar deta hai, kabhi dusri country kar deti hai, it becomes comparatively difficult in that context to negotiate. Agar you are adding five more countries or other countries into the permanent seat and giving them the veto power, it will become comparatively more difficult to negotiate on issues. Issues like world peace, as a Security Council, demands swift action. There is a need that the action that is given should be comparatively very swift. But when the number of members are more, it will definitely be taking the time consuming to come to a conclusion. And therefore, the peace and security of the world would be comparatively endangered by this system. As a bulk of the operations, they are basically being approved by the Security Council or financed by the industrialized countries, nations. They should have a main role in the deciding on an action. Agar jyada se jyada operation jo bhi hain, they are basically being undertaken and they are basically being financed by the developed nation. वो कभी नहीं कहेंगे कि हमारा रोल इंटरनेशनल सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल के डिसीजन मेकिंग में कंपैरेटिवली कम हो जाए बिकॉज इट इज देयर हु दे हु आर बेसिकली कंट्रीब्यूटिंग टू इट द फाइनेंसेस द डेवलपिंग नेशन ऑलरेडी हैव अ वॉइस इन द काउंसिल बट दे शुड नॉट हैव अ वीटो पावर ओवर द डिसीजंस इन द कंटेक्स्ट कि द डिसीजंस व्हिच आर नॉट बीइंग फाइनेंस्ड बाय दीस कंट्रीज They should not be given the veto power to take on those decisions. The reforms on the Security Council can take place only if 2/3 of the United Nations members they vote in favor of the reforms, along with the affirmative vote from all the permanent members. 2/3 members hi nahi, but there is an affirmative vote that is required from all the permanent members who are basically enjoying the veto power. Effectively, even if India secures the support of 2/3 of the members who are present and voting, it will still be needing the yes of the 5 permanent members so that they should not use their veto against India, thereby prevent the adoption of the reform process. In that case, it becomes important ki aapko alag-alag dimension se is question ka answer pata hona chahiye. For example, if the opposition is there, coffee club, ya wo aap likh sakte ho. But in the context that what other developments are taking place, ki France or UK kyun oppose kar raha hai, Germany or Japan is why is not that much reserving presently. Hostilities within in the context that ki Nigeria, Egypt, South Africa, yahan pe kya chal raha hai, India ke candidature ko kyun oppose kiya ja raha hai, Brazil ko kyun oppose kiya ja raha hai. Aur agar hum expand bhi kar dete hai, what will be the possible problems that would be emerging from it? Or those countries which are basically financing the operation, how can they say ki chalo theek hai hum finance to hum kar rahe hain lekin decision making mein hamari say nahi chahiye. In that case it becomes important that agar developing countries ko voice bhi humne deni hai, how much it is justified that they are taking the decisions on those issues for which they are not providing the finances. और अल्टीमेटली अब एंड में लिखना है कि 2/3 मेजॉरिटी तो चाहिए ही चाहिए बट इवन द येस ऑफ दोज 5 मेंबर्स आर इक्वली इंपॉर्टेंट सो दैट दे शुड नॉट बी एक्सरसाइजिंग देयर वीटो पावर सो इस तरीके से आप इस क्वेश्चन की आंसर को लिख सकते हो सो दैट इट इज़ वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव अब पूरे का पूरा ही आंसर मॉडल आंसर कैन बी दे द नेक्स्ट पॉसिबल क्वेश्चन दैट वी वुड बी डिस्कसिंग इज बेसिकली कंसर्न अबाउट The fourth industrial revolution. What is fourth industrial revolution? Critically comment upon the way it would transform human lives. कि किस तरीके से human lives को transform करने की कर सकता है. The fourth, when you talk about the fourth industrial revolution, it is basically marked by the fusion of the technologies. The fusion of the technologies would be taking place straddling across the physical world, the biological world, and the digital world. The fusion of the technologies would be taking place. And if the fusion of the technologies would be taking place, straddling physical, kar liya, great kar rahe hain, aur governance is being done, it would be, everything would be transformed. That's a common feature in the fourth industrial revolution. And with these features, for example, robots, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, big data, nanotechnology, etc., etc., that will be leading to the faster innovations of the very cycles that are taking place. In the context that now we would be producing cheaper goods and services. If the goods would be comparatively cheaper, services would be cheaper, that will drive a new wave of economic growth that is taking place. As the production is increasing, that will be lifting the global incomes. Income bhi badh jayegi. It will also improve the lives worldwide. And for example, the robots which are there at presently, there may be humans that may be working in different situations. Now the robots can be used. They can be used in factories, in homes, in hospitals, in shops, in restaurants, etc. When the robots or machines are working, that will also be leading to increase in efficiency in production also. That is in the context of production system. In the context of governance, it will be leading to improvement in the governance system. In the context that it will revolutionize the way government and the citizens are interacting with each other. As there would be more emphasis that would be given on transparency. Transparency ke upar kafi jyada emphasis kiya jayega. For example, there may be robots that may be used. The robots may be used in the management of the traffic. Traffic ko kis tarike se manage karna hai, wo robots honge, to robots they would be working on this consideration. And therefore, that will be leading to increase in efficiency with optimum utilization of different resources. That would leading to the deepening of the inequalities and widening of the gap between the wealth gap between the developed and the developing countries. Advanced manufacturing and service sector. And if there would be good amount of automation that is taking place, that would be leading to mass amount of unemployment, and that would be disrupting the labor market. For example, the World Economic Forum, it says that the 5 million jobs would be lost in 15 major economies by 2020 just because of the use of technology and other areas. And say that the countries, for example, India, the country, for example, Latin America, these countries would be adversely affected. Not only this, but there would also be a heavy generation of the e-waste that is also taking place. Better support system would be there. There can be education. There can be better cyber security. That in the future, it is the talent which will be representing the critical factor in production. Ki apne reality mein talent kya hai, that will play a major role in the production system. Not ki the documents, for example, or the certificates which you are having. It will be the talent that will play a major role ki apne kaise kaise karna. Friends, we would be ending the class over here itself. Those students who have still not joined the Plus platform, they can use my referral code Maluka10. And using the referral code Maluka10, you will get a 10% discount on all the courses which are being run on the Plus platform. Thank you very much.